Oregon lawmakers this week unveiled a proposal to fix Oregon's crumbling highways and traffic nightmares. The plan includes improvements to infamous stretches of highway like Interstate 5 near the Rose Quarter.
This is one of the highest capacity corridors in the state of Oregon right in here, and it's got one of the highest crash rates in the state as well.
But fixing our roads isn't cheap. Lawmakers are discussing a gas tax, increased fees, and even a tax on new bicycles to pay for everything. Tonight, two perspectives on the plan. We'll talk to a state senator who helped draft the proposal. Plus, the Port of Portland director explains the huge impact traffic congestion has on our economy. From KGW News, this is Straight Talk with Laural Porter.
Hello and welcome to Straight Talk. I'm Laural Porter. The Oregon legislature passed the halfway mark a couple of weeks ago. And with less than 2 months left in the legislative session, lawmakers are ramping up business. Two must-do items: fill a budget gap of $1.6 billion and pass a transportation package, something they couldn't get done last session. Tonight, we tackle the transportation challenge. It's important to a lot of Oregonians who are tired of being stuck in traffic and dealing with crumbling infrastructure and worries about seismically unsafe bridges. And now lawmakers have come up with a blueprint on how to address that. Tonight, we talk with a lawmaker who helped craft the draft proposal. And later in the show, we hear from the director of the Port of Portland, Bill Wyatt, and get his take on the plan. First, welcome to my guest, State Senator Rod Monroe. He represents Senate District 24, which includes East Portland and North Clackamas County. He's a retired teacher and co-chair of the Ways and Means Education Subcommittee and a member of the Business and Transportation Committee. He tells me he's on three transportation committees. We did reach out to Senate Republicans to join us for Straight Talk today, and they declined our invitation. Welcome to Straight Talk. It's great to have you here.
Well, thank you, Laural. It's good to be here.
This is something we all hear a lot. I know you hear it. The traffic is so bad and it's getting worse. You have been in transportation issues for a long time. You've dealt with it. How did we get to this point where it's so bad?
Well, the legislature simply has been ignoring the problem or kicking the can down the road. Instead of passing additional fees and keeping up with the maintenance on our highways, and now we're facing the big earthquake that everybody says is coming, and our bridges are all 70 years old or older, and if that earthquake comes before we fix them, they'll crumble into the sea or into the river.
Well, Senator, we dug into our KGW archives to look at one of the last times that the state made a really big investment. You said a lot of the roads and bridges are 70 years old. In 1958, the state made a big investment in the second span over the Columbia River, the I-5 bridge, and also the Banfield Freeway. So we found a report by Tom McCall, who you say that you worked with. He was a reporter here at KGW and, of course, became governor later. Let's listen to what he said about that big investment back in 1958.
It was a year for ceremonies dedicating bridges and freeways, bridges like the $12 million Morrison Street span across the Willamette River. But even this monster of metal and concrete had to defer in the size department to the $14 million interstate span between Portland and Vancouver. Glowing words and bright sunshine keynoted the dedication of this 3,500-foot link in U.S. Highway 99, the largest bridge the Oregon Highway Department ever had a hand in building. In contrasting weather, ceremonies brought into service the final link of the $15 million Banfield Freeway connecting Portland's east side with U.S. Highway 30. State highway builders awarded a record $68 million worth of contracts in 1958, and in 1959, they'll do even better.
Isn't that fascinating to watch? But watching that, it occurred to me that the state at that time, the government, made a big investment, not only in our roads and our bridges, but also in our schools. You were a teacher. You taught for a long time. Now Portland Public Schools is asking for a huge bond, the biggest in state history, to rebuild some of the schools. Franklin, where you taught, was built with the last bond. So that generation really stepped up and built schools, built bridges and roads. Is this a generational call with your plan for people of today to step up instead of kicking the can down the road again?
Absolutely. This is something that we must succeed in. Absolutely must. This is an export state, and we have to be able to get goods from all over the state, from Eastern Oregon and Southern Oregon, through Portland to the port, and away to our foreign ports. If we can't do that, and if our roads are so clogged up with highway, with travel back and forth all the time, then this state is going to shrivel. We have to do it, and we have to do it now, and we must succeed.
Let's look at part of your blueprint, your $8 billion plan. This is part of it. $450 million to add lanes and fix a ramp on I-5 in the Rose Quarter. $202 million to widen and retrofit Abernathy Bridge on I-205 to withstand earthquakes. $250 million to widen I-205 between Stafford Road and Oregon City. $98 million to add lanes in both directions on Highway 217. And more than $30 million for traffic management and bottleneck projects. And Senator, we'll show you a graphic that we have of one of those projects that's really focused on the Portland area, and that is the I-5 Rose Quarter area that Don Hamilton from the Oregon Department of Transportation says is really one of the highest crash corridors and it has some of the most traffic. Why so much emphasis in the Portland area?
Well, people in Eastern Oregon and in Southern Oregon understand that if they want to get their goods to market, they've got to come through the Portland area and particularly the Rose Quarter area. The problem with the Rose Quarter and with I-205 is that you have a six-lane freeway, three lanes in each direction, narrowing down to two lanes in each direction, and you get gridlock. And you see that gridlock every day, both at the Rose Quarter and on I-205 between the Abernathy Bridge and Stafford Road. So widening those two freeways to three lanes each direction will allow the free flow of commerce, which is critical to the entire state, not just to the Portland area.
Let's talk about how you want to pay for all this. This is a big ask, and you're asking to increase the gas tax by 14 cents to 44 cents per gallon. This would be over 10 years. Increasing title fees by $40 to $117. That, again, is over 10 years. Increasing registration fees by $40 to $83 and adding a tiered structure over the same period. A 0.1% payroll tax, that's an employee tax. 5% tax on new bicycle sales and a 1% tax on new vehicle sales. That is a long list of taxes and fees. Is this going to be politically challenging because you're also going to have to try to fill that budget gap? So you may be trying to raise revenue to fill that too. So that's a lot of revenue that you're talking about.
Well, we're worrying about the transportation right now. I know the budget problem is a problem, and I know that Senator Hass, who's the chair of the budget committee, is working on that. But the transportation needs are tremendous, and we cannot fund transit needs out of the highway fund. So you have the highway fund, which is the gas tax and the auto registration and the title fees. And by the way, we're trying to finesse that so that those people, even those people that drive electric cars and don't use any gas at all, will pay something because they do use the roads. So the highway fund is one thing, but transit, every place we went in the state last summer, we went all over the state, people said, we need better transit. We can't, you know, older people that don't drive anymore can't get to church, can't get to shopping. We need better transit. And so we heard that, and we developed this transit fee for all commerce so that people would pay a little tiny bit, about 0.5% on all payrolls from all over, and that would create about $100 million a year just for transit, because the Constitution says we can't use the highway fund for buses and light rail and things like that.
You're also talking about possibly a rush hour tolling. How would that work?
Well, the tolling is probably the most controversial suggestion in this package, and believe me, it's just a suggestion. Frankly, I'm not sure the Oregonians are ready for that kind of tolling. Back east, they toll everything. But most Oregonians are kind of, you know, they don't like tolling, they don't like self-service gas, and they don't like sales tax.
The tolling's right in there with that. Not only do they not like tolling, some people who ride bicycles don't really like that new bicycle tax. You're getting some pushback from bicycle advocates on that. And we talked to Jonathan Moss, the editor and publisher of Bike Portland, who told us he thinks it's bad policy. So let's listen to what he said, and then I'll get your response.
Okay.
It's clearly a political move so that we can get some people to vote for the transportation package. You know, we have lawmakers with constituents who just constantly are saying this mantra of, you know, bicyclists don't pay their way and that sort of thing. It's not true. It's not a good policy direction for the state necessarily. We, as a society, typically, we don't tax things that are not luxuries. We don't tax things that have no negative impact on society. Bicycles are a great thing for the state. There's no negative impact. They're not a luxury item, you know, like tobacco or some like marijuana, some other thing.
Senator, how do you respond to that?
Well, he's right. People that don't like bicycles very much say, why are you spending all this money on all these bike trails and bicycles aren't paying anything? And I said, well, this package includes an excise tax on bicycles, but only on adult bicycles over 26 inches and over $500. So if somebody wants to ride a less expensive bicycle, they won't pay this at all. And we're also proposing an excise tax on the purchase of new automobiles. That would be much more significant, raise much more money than this little token 5% tax on expensive adult bicycles.
Republicans say that this is a myriad of taxes that are going to be unpopular with voters, and you're going to need some Republican support to pass any kind of bill because it's raising revenue and you need a supermajority, yeah. Which means you need at least two Republicans, one in the Senate and one in the House. Do you think you have that Republican support? Can you get it?
Well, you know, the committee that was appointed is balanced equally between Republicans and Democrats. And we've had several Republican senators and representatives that have been in leadership in this whole process. They're on board. And so absolutely, we need a bipartisan support for this bipartisan plan because Oregon is one state, and it's one state that needs to be able to move freight and move people safely without being congested all the time. Republicans understand that as well as Democrats. So this program is an Oregon program. It's not a Democratic plan, not a Republican plan.
This is one of the things I've seen that they want to do something like kind of tit for tat. They want to see an overhaul of the low carbon fuel standard that was passed last legislative session. And that is what tanked the transportation package last time, that disagreement. Do you see that happening again?
Well, I certainly hope not. I've talked to several Republican legislators who said, Rod, we're not going to let that happen this time. This transportation package is too important. We've got to vote on it standing on its own merit and the merit for the state of Oregon.
You know, there's a lot of skepticism amongst voters, and they're all for let's fix this transportation problem, let's get, you know, better traffic patterns. But they're skeptical of how government uses taxpayer money. And all they have to do in this state is look at the Columbia River crossing and what happened with that plan being scrapped, $200 million wasted on that, that could have paid for half of this I-5 bridge project. How can you ensure voters, if they step up to pass this, convince them that that money will be spent wisely and efficiently? Will there be a watchdog group?
Absolutely, there is going to be a watchdog group. And in fact, the committee that we've established has a watchdog group already assigned for that task to make sure that ODOT, Oregon Department of Transportation, spends this money wisely and carefully. Different transportation, local transportation MPOs around the state are going to be involved in determining which projects are built and which are not built. So this is all going to be, the local control is going to be there all the way along. And with respect to the Columbia River crossing, you know, Oregon did right by the Columbia River crossing. It was a couple of wackos up in Washington that killed it. And they're going to rule the day because every day the traffic is getting worse for those almost 100,000 Washingtonians that have to work in Oregon and that have to travel here every day in that terrible congestion. They're going to wish they had that light rail connection.
Just a few seconds left, Senator. Are you looking for leadership from Governor Brown to shepherd this through?
I already have leadership from Governor Brown. She's absolutely 100% in favor of what we're doing. And we're her staff, her key staff people on transportation, been meeting with me on a regular basis. They're an integral part of the whole plan.
So we'll be looking forward to a bill soon.
Oh, yes. We're crafting it right now.
Senator Rod Monroe, thank you for joining us here on Straight Talk.
You bet.
And when we come back, we'll talk with the Port of Portland's Bill Wyatt to find out what he thinks about the transportation plan. We're back in 2 minutes.